Hey guys, welcome to Dragon's Voice podcast. I am your host, truly Reese Deans, and it's been quite an adventure recently. And for some reason, I'm finding a theme here a lot because it seems to be Wrexham going on here. I had Steve Evans, I had Lee Jones. Oh, Flamenek, I don't know what's going on here. And I think I'm spotting a bit of a pattern because recently it's just all been Wrexham, but now this is another one. And I hope he gets his name right because I've been getting two different pronunciations of his names, but it's none other than a Wrexham legend. It's Shaun Pejic. Is it, if I pronounce
it? Yeah, that's well pronounced.
Oh, so where does your name come from then? Where does the name come from then?
My grandfather was Serbian, so it comes from Serbia. Actually, the correct pronunciation in Serbian is Pejic. But my grandfather came over, he met my nan, who was English. And back in the day, they kind of made the name sound more English by calling it Pejic, I guess. Since my dad was born and myself, we were known as Pejics or Pej, as some of the Wrexham fans might remember me as Pej. So yeah.
But speaking of Wrexham, you're considered a Wrexham legend. You know a well popular name, playing for Wrexham for what was it, just nearly over a decade, wasn't it? So but what was it like just to play for Wrexham, especially at a time now? And I say this to Steve Evans. I don't think I said it to Lee Jones at the time because this wasn't happening, but Hollywood is coming to Wrexham for some reason.
That's what the rumors are. Yeah. I don't know if that's actually going to happen. It would be great if, get that investment of money into the club. I think it would be huge for the club, whether it happens or not. I have no idea.
And it was just another thing as well, because Ryan Reynolds is one of the investors and we all know him as Deadpool and he's been in a lot of films, but he's Canadian. And you're living in Canada at the moment, Vancouver, yeah. Is that right?
So, that's right.
So before we get on to the career path, you know, of playing for Wrexham and everything like that. So what was the reason? What was the sole reason of moving to Canada then?
Well, initially, after I left Wrexham, I moved around clubs a little bit. I went to like York City. But I had this kind of urge to want to go play in the US originally. So, a few things happened. And then I eventually got talking to Vancouver Whitecaps team, football team, or they call it soccer right here. And I came over to Vancouver with basically like a week's worth of clothes in a suitcase and came over, played, signed for the Vancouver Whitecaps, played with them for the rest of the season and fell in love with the city. The city is a beautiful city. Everyone's really nice in Vancouver. And I really enjoyed my time living and playing in kind of North America, Canada, and the US at the time. It was a great experience. So, yeah, and then a few things happened. And then I just came back to Vancouver after I decided to say I'm too old and I can't run anymore. I'm like, okay, let's do something new. And came back to Vancouver. And now, living in Vancouver. Now I work at Electronic Arts, making FIFA video games. So I'm like a gameplay producer now for FIFA. So yeah, it's an interesting transition from playing the game to now making a video game of football, which is a pretty cool transition.
Let's just keep me in you, right? Can I get one, I can use a demo. I'm kidding. Let's go back to the beginning, then. So born in Hereford, and for some, just looking into the research, and because of the time difference here, funny enough, I will be honest with you, I did not have enough time to do my research, but I got most of it down. But I love doing natural, just chattings, whatever, and just like talk about anything. But I luckily got this down just sooner rather than later. But you joined Wrexham at the age of 14, is that right? And you did this training scheme, for the youth training scheme. So how did that happen? And what was it like to first join Wrexham?
Yeah, funnily enough, my father, my dad, Mel, was a player too. He played football. As I was born in Hereford, as you mentioned, my dad at the time played for Hereford football team. And then I was born there. I was, you know, eight or seven years old. And then my dad got transferred, actually, or he moved from Hereford Football Club to Wrexham Football Club when Brian Flynn was the manager. I don't remember the dates now, but he obviously brought me and my brother and my mum over to, we lived in Chester at the time, but he played for Wrexham. And then, so obviously I've been around football since I can remember, watching my dad play or watching TV and been kicking the ball around in the garden. And then, like you said, 14, 12, 13, 14, I was actually playing a lot of football in schools and for local teams, and yeah, managed to get into the Wrexham kind of scholarship system at a younger ages, and went through the ranks at the younger ages through Wrexham, which was a great experience. Learning the roots of playing the game, knowing the ins and outs of everything. And then it kind of stuck. I kind of enjoyed playing for Wrexham and made my debut for Wrexham first team. I think I was 17, if I remember correctly, against Port Vale away from home. I was just a skinny little kid playing on a pitch with a bunch of like fully grown, big bearded men. So I was a bit of a nervous wreck, but yeah, I think that was kind of like a high level how it went, really.
So when you first started playing for Wrexham, they were sort of in the third division at the time, and it was getting to the point, because with the whole changing of the system, was just, it was inevitable that the changing of the system was going to come, because we now call it, you know, the first division is the Championship, then you got League One, League Two, and everything. But when you first put on the Wrexham shirt and everything, what was it like just to be at the racecourse ground, just to be playing at that particular ground?
Yeah, I mean, it's a really, really nice ground, and the support is a great support. Obviously, the Welsh, the Wrexham fans are very passionate about football and about their team. So yeah, playing at the racecourse ground for the first time was a really great experience. The fans were very welcoming. I think they probably knew that I was like the son of Mel. I think most of the fans knew my dad played. So at first, yeah, it was a great experience. The fans were very welcoming and trying to rally me on, which was great to kind of hear. And like I said, the support and the atmosphere of the stadium was to add to it too. Being a young guy coming into the first team was a great rush of energy and kind of got your blood pumping. It was a really cool experience.
And let's get on to it then with the 2002 and 2003 season. Became a regular first team player, a fan favorite as well, you know, just sort of getting into the fan favorite motif, as they say. And you were got promoted second division and the FAW Premier Cup. And that must have been one hell of a season, one hell of a year for Wrexham. I mean, I want to talk about that FAW Premier Cup. The only reason I do it, I absolutely love it because of how unique it is and how it's not your typical cup where you look at it, it's like a wooden ball with a metal symbol at the center. I absolutely love it. I just think it's absolutely brilliant. But what was it like to be playing in the FAW Premier Cup, especially, you know, playing against teams from the Welsh League system at the time?
Yeah, I mean, it was kind of like something different, you know, like being a player, playing in like the, like it's a League Two or Three back then in England, playing against obviously these bigger teams, you could argue. But yeah, there's something different of playing against the local teams and the local like Welsh specific team, where it was something different. It was a really, really good experience knowing that it was like kind of a Welsh driven thing. And again, the support for those games was, even though there were lower numbers, there's still the atmosphere and the feeling on the pitch was just as intense as an English like League 2-3 game was. So yeah, it was, and especially winning it too, was pretty special. Even though I'm not, well, I should say I'm like, I've got half Welsh blood in me, so I did play for the Welsh team at 21. So yeah, being a kind of half Welsh guy, not fully Welsh, it was extra special too.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if you're half Welsh or not, you still got Welsh blood in you.
that's
the main thing, you know. The thing is as well, it's like the whole point of this podcast, I'll just try and explain a bit more, is that it doesn't matter if you've contributed to Welsh football in any capacity, whether even if you like you said, you're half Welsh, but you've played in English football, you're still going to get that benefit anyway, because you've got Welsh blood in you. It's like with the national team anyway. But it's like, but I always let off with a few people anyways, like Andy Campbell, who was a Cardiff City legend. He came on the show, but the only reason I let him come on the show is because he was a Cardiff City hero, you know, a hero to a Welsh football club. So it kind of suits the theme or the rules of my podcast. But sometimes I break him anyway, and I just go, oh, it's for fun anyway. But it's like, just going back with the FAW Premier Cup, though. For some reasons, Wrexham and Newport, they've always been, you know, another derby because of the North and South regions, and they've always been at the same level of football. But in the FAW Premier Cup, when you won it, you thrashed them 6-1 or something like that. What was that? And especially at home. What was it like to play in that match, and or if you did play in that match, and what was it like just to defeat Newport 6-1? Because that was a big result, you know.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember all those years ago now. I mean, beating anyone like by that amount of goals, 6-1, is pretty amazing experience, especially being like another Welsh team. Like you said, there's that rivalry between the north and the south of Wales, and there's always this kind of argument and fight, who's got the better teams, is it the north or the south? And and back then, beating the kind of like the competition, you'd say back then, 6-1 was a really special moment, I guess, especially for all the fans in the north, the Wrexham fans. So I don't remember the day itself, it was too long ago. We probably had a few beers at the end of the game and had a good celebration, but But I can imagine it being a good day.
Do you have any good stories to talk about this particular person? That's Steve Evans. You know, he was your defence partner, you know, and I had him on the show. He actually said, oh, get Shaun on here. You probably love that. And, you know, and he's a character himself, because he's, you know, I've always said he's one of the key representations of Welsh League football. You know, he's gone from the Welsh League system and he's gone on to play for Wrexham and to play for the international teams, you know. And but if you've got any good stories to talk about Steve Evans at all?
I'll have to keep it under, like, not too extreme. But, Steve and I played a lot together when he first came to the club. I can't remember what team he joined from, but, he came from the Welsh Leagues and came to Wrexham. And I remember walking into the training one day and seeing him. He's not the most prettiest of boys around to look at, but he's a big, unique figure. And he's on the pitch. He's like dominates the air play, like wins every header pretty much. He's very aggressive. And having Nat, who played like as a two centre backs, me and him, having Nat next to me was such a good partnership. I felt like he was the guy that did all the big, heavy lifting kind of grappling work, and I was like mostly covering him, and every time he made a mistake I'd try and be there to clean up a little bit. So I think our partnership on the pitch was really good, and also off the pitch we got on really well, and I think that helps generate that relationship on the pitch if you get on off the pitch too, and you kind of like have each other's back, as let's say. He's a great guy. He's a great character, and obviously being a local boy too in Wrexham was a great, he had such passion for the team and wanted to try and do a win in every game he could. So it was great.
Yeah, the one thing I want to mention, speaking of derbies, and it's come to mind, the cross-border derby between Wrexham and Chester. You must have played your fair share of, you know, derbies. Yeah. And I think it's so many questions to ask, so I'll start off with this one. I asked with Steve, how tense is the cross-border derby? How I don't want to say how bad it is, because that's not the correct term. It's just how crazy it is. What kind of derby is it like?
Yeah, it's for me playing for Wrexham growing up, and you always knew that there's that rivalry between Chester and Wrexham, and myself growing up actually in Chester was a little bit more strange, because a lot of my friends from school when I was younger were Chester fans as well. So so yeah, I could feel the rivalry there between the fans, and the wanting to kind of have the edge over the other team. Just the kind of talk and the chit chat you do after the games between the fans was, I think, mostly part of it. They wanted to know that they were the best. So yeah, there were very intense games as well, and you knew that when you played Wrexham against Chester on the pitch, it was going to be a rough game. It was going to be a tough game. Lots of flying tackles and very emotional games, which was great playing in. Obviously, you want to play in those games where you can just feel the intensity of them. Yeah, and you could feel that in the atmosphere too when you played against Chester. Both sets of fans would give each other stick throughout the whole game, and there'd be all this kind of banter back and forth, and kind of added to the emotion of it. It was really, it didn't have a, trying to remember how many it had. I had at least a handful of those experiences playing Wrexham Chester. So yeah, it was pretty amazing experiences. Yeah.
Does any particular game that stands out for you, whether it's result or whether is it atmosphere or just the event itself?
There was a couple. I don't remember the exact times we played, because I think mostly when I was playing for Wrexham, we, being the Welsh guy, we were like winning most of the games when we played Chester. It was very rare that they'd come to Wrexham or we'd go to Chester and they'd beat us. It was maybe once or twice, not very often. Most of the time Wrexham would win, so we always went into the pitch pretty confidently, and we were like, okay, these guys are on paper not as good as us, so we should be able to deal with them. But I don't recall. I think I remember playing at Chester once, and we started the game really well. I think we scored early, I think they scored late on. I don't remember the exact timing of it now, but we ended up winning the game. But it was an intense game, and coming away with a win at Chester too was a great, great one that I remember. Especially with, I remember being in the pitch, and I could actually remember seeing my school friends in the stadium giving me stick and trying to like wind me up on the pitch and stuff like that. So having a one over on those like old mates of mine was pretty funny and pretty good too.
During your time at Wrexham, of course you got called up to play for Wales U21s and everything. So how did you became eligible to play for Wales? Was it from your mother's or your dad's side? Or
my mother's side. Yeah, my mother. Her parents were both Welsh. They're actually from South Wales. My mum's parents were both Welsh. My dad's side was obviously half English, half Serbian. So I had the option actually to play for three national teams, but England and Serbia didn't come asking me to play. So
you picked the right one anyway.
I picked the right one, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So no, playing for Wales was such a great honour on the 21 level. That was pretty amazing experience going to Cardiff. It was when we had all the training sessions and we got together as a team with all these other great players around England and Wales. That was something I'll never forget too.
Jumping on into the future now with Wrexham, there was a moment where the club was struggling financially, and of course I'll probably get down to that in a moment. But I wanted to say this. I wanted to ask and talk about this particular story, which was the time when Wrexham were in a relegation battle and you played against Boston United. And both of you were, both teams, they had to win or one had to draw to stay up or something like that. It was on Sky Sports. Jeff Stelling had to report it. I remember, I think it was Brian Law who was reporting it. He's a Wrexham lad, so he was happy. But what was it like for you the emotions, the pressure and the responsibility you had when you went into that game?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously, yeah, like you said, we were battling for relegation, and if we lost that game, I think we were going to go down. I think, like you said, and Boston were also down there too. So like it was like fight for your life to survive type of game. And I remember going in the bus on the way down there. I don't know what it was, but something inside you could just feel like confidence there. You're like, okay, I know it's obviously really high pressure and we have to win the game, but I just had something there. We're like, we've got some good players here. We've got a good squad of a team. And we all had that kind of high anticipation that we knew what we were going to do on the pitch. We knew the plan, what we were going to do. And I think obviously all the lads were passionate and very, we wanted to win the game. Obviously, our blood was pumping before the game started, because we knew how important it was to win that game, survive, and keep ourselves in the league. So, yeah, and obviously on the pitch, remember the atmosphere was quite high, and everyone was obviously really nervous at the same time. But actually, I do remember the score now. But I think we obviously won the game, or we drew. I don't remember now.
We
But
won. Yeah,
yeah,
you guys won
we won it.
3-1. Yeah,
Nice, nice. Yeah.
it was Ryan Valentine, Chris Llewellyn, and I think it was something Proctor. It was Proctor.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's coming back to me a little bit now. Yeah.
It's all right.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, yeah, winning. And then obviously at the end of the game, when you win the game, just the release of energy. And we're like, okay, we're obviously passionate about winning this game. We did it. And staying up in the league was pretty cool. Yeah.
It was absolutely. Do you know what? I remember I had to do a list of the top five or top 10 best Welsh football moments. And I think I put down Wrexham and Boston United game as number 9 or 8, even though I wasn't there. But
Nice.
just looking into the story as well because of how important it was. And I know it doesn't really justify the story afterwards because Wrexham eventually did go down. But just that moment alone, you know, the nice sunny day at Wrexham at the racecourse, just 12,000 people turning up, filling the cop as well. Well, the Wrexham's cop, and you know, it's just a big moment. And I've spoken to Steve about it, and he, you know, he was just sat there thinking, flipping heck, you know, that game was something else, you know. So, but it's like any other game, you know, where, I mean, me being a Barry Town supporter, you know, I've seen my fair share of, you know, games where I thought to myself, I'm gonna convert into alcoholism in a minute. All this stress of a crying out loud, what's going on here? But that's football because it is life, it is passion, and it does
Is, you know.
drive you in. But what a story it is, you know, to have that. When Wrexham did go down, how did you feel when the team went down and the financial problems were beginning to unravel?
Yeah, obviously really tough. And football, as being a player and a fan, has got highs and lows, and it's obviously this wave of emotions. And like we've talked about earlier, there's a few highs for me being a player, and this one of having the administration, getting the points deducted, and then like I said, a couple of years later, having more financial problems, and seeing ourselves come at the bottom of the league, and then eventually getting relegated was a really difficult time. Not just for the club, but for all the players too. Because yeah, getting relegated is obviously never something you want to do. You obviously want to win every game, and you want to play at the best, highest level you possibly can. So yeah, back then I think there was change of management. I think I don't remember, Brian Little was in charge, and Brian Carey was there for a little bit too. So there was a lot of changes going on back then, and new faces in the team, and yeah, obviously it didn't work out in the end, and we ended up getting relegated. So I think obviously it was emotional time. I don't remember. I remember like I was in and out of the team a little bit back then, and there was new faces coming in and stuff. So I think just the general like team spirit, or the core players were, there was some challenges there with all these things going on, as well as the financial side of things was building up on people's minds. And I remember some weeks and some months we were like, the club's in such a difficult financial state that there were times where we worried that we were not even going to get paid and things like this, which were No matter what you do, that's always going to play in the back of your mind on the pitch too. So yeah, it was a tough time, and sad that it happened, but it did. So yeah, it's a tricky one.
But let's try and bring this back into a big positive now and go back in time. Yeah. The Football League Trophy, which is also an accomplishment that you've achieved with Wrexham, but the names, the players that were playing for Wrexham at the time, let alone the 2002 and 3 or 3 and 4 seasons of Wrexham, but 2004-05 season was a quite, if I can name, I got it on my phone here, if I can name some of these people. So obviously you were on there. There was Danny Williams, there was Mark Jones, Matt Crowell, if I pronounce it right, Chris Llewellyn, Craig Morgan, Stephen Roberts, a lot of former Wales international players, first team players as well. Then you had Andy Holtz, yep. Carlos Edwards, Ben Foster. Ben Foster, yeah. Flipping heck, you know. You had, I mean, and even Juan, if I can pronounce his name, Juan Ugarte.
Yeah.
And I'm on a roll here. And this one player that sticks out, and he is a Ferguson. It's Darren Ferguson. Yeah. You know what? A squad.
That yeah, it was a great team.
What? Who's manager there? Oh, I'm going to have to look it up again now. I had the list going.
Dennis Smith was the manager back then, yeah.
He must have been quite a manager, Dennis Smith, from the sound of things.
Yeah, he was, yeah. He, like you said, he brought in some great players, some great loan. I think Ben Foster was on loan at the time. But he brought, over the years, he brought in a lot of like good, young, like loanee players from like higher clubs, from like the Premier League clubs, I should say. Like Matt Derbyshire was well known for Blackburn. He ended up having a great career, scoring a bunch of goals. I can list a couple as low as them. But yeah, that squad specifically was a lot of Welsh guys too, which was great. But Dennis Smith was, I had a lot of success playing with him. He changed the formation to play like three at the back and have like wing backs and more in the midfield. And he played myself on the right of the back three with either Dennis Lawrence or Stephen Evans or like Steve Roberts, like you said. And Craig Morgan was obviously had a great career too. So just that back three would work really well. And we had some really quick attacking players too. I think we didn't really, that team, we weren't really afraid of anyone. We kind of went out on the pitch and we were like, right, we've got these quick, really attack-minded players. So let's just go out on the pitch and just have no fear and play kind of freely. And Dennis Smith kind of like ingrained this into us, as well as he was quite good on in the training pitch of like defensively when the ball was here, we'd know where to be as a team. We'd know where to press and what to do in certain situations. And I think that helped me specifically. I think it helped the team and we had lots of success from it. Yeah, it was a great couple of years. We had some great players on that team too.
I need to mention Darren Ferguson, and obviously, of course, you know, he's come from football royalty, being the son of Sir Alex Ferguson. He's played for Manchester United, he's won the Premier League, you know, he came from Sparta Rotterdam as well, that also mentions as well, because recently before we did the podcast, you know, Ben Woodburn, a Welsh international, he was rumoured to go and play for Sparta Rotterdam. I'm a bit gutted about that, but I'll probably do that another time to express my frustrations when I put them. But for some reason, Darren Ferguson's became another club legend. You know, what was it like to play with him? What was he like as a person? And did Alex Ferguson ever come to watch a Wrexham game at all?
Yeah. I mean, like Darren was a great figure on and off the pitch. He, like I say, he's been around the block. He's really experienced. Played at high levels, and he had that experience off the pitch. I remember him kind of having a high standard in training and maintaining like as much fitness as possible. I don't think he was the fittest guy back then. He was getting on a little bit in his age, but even on when we were training, even if we made like one kind of sloppy pass or one mistake, he'd be on your case. He'd be like, come on, we've got to raise the standards and we've got to play at this high level. And also like he'd recognize the game, what was happening in game situations. If they had some weakness on the opponent's team that we should try and like make the most of. He'd have that experience to know how to win games, the man management side of games, which was obviously great to have on your team, that kind of person in the middle of the pitch to control situations and to try and like figure out ways to win matches or to survive and not like score goals and stuff like that. So yeah, he was a great great kind of leader on and off the pitch to have on your team. He was a pretty cool guy to play with, and he was obviously high standards, so at times he'd bark orders and he'd get on your nerves, but we all knew what his intent was, to try and keep that high standard. So even though sometimes he'd get on your nerves and he'd probably say the wrong thing and upset some people, but yeah, at the end, the intent was good to try and keep that high level. Yeah.
Did you ever get to meet Alex Ferguson?
Yeah, he came to a couple of games, Wrexham games, and was watching from the stands. I think actually I went to Darren Ferguson's wedding, or the reception of his wedding, and Alex Ferguson was there. So yeah, I remember walking around and having like a 2-minute nervous chat with him at the table during the reception of Darren's wedding, which was pretty extreme too. Just seeing him there, like, oh shit, that's Alex Ferguson sitting over there.
I could just see it now. I would be the same. If someone, if Alex Ferguson turned up to my wedding, I'd be going, hi, how's it going? Nice to meet you.
Yeah, I know, yeah. You're like, what do I say? I'm going to like sound like intelligent, but I'm like, this Alex Ferguson, what are you saying? Like,
yeah. What can we talk about football without insulting his intelligence? What's going on?
I know. He's not going to learn anything from me playing for Wrexham when he's a Man United legend. But anyway, yeah, it was cool. Yeah.
With the Football League trophy then, and going into the final, you were up against Southend and you won 2-0, and Darren Ferguson was one of the goal scorers. But it was at the Millennium Stadium, because at the time there was a new Wembley on the go, but it was taking a while to be built. What was it like to have won that trophy, especially at the Millennium Stadium? Or did you feel like it could have been at a reasonable stadium like the Racecourse?
I remember going down on the bus to obviously Cardiff for the Millennium Stadium, and there was, even just driving to the stadium before the game, I just remember driving through all these Wrexham fans. There was so many fans. I don't remember the exact attendance of the game, but it was like 20,000 plus. I can't remember the exact numbers, but it just had that feeling of, this is obviously a really big game for the Welsh supporters. Being in Cardiff and Wales specifically was an amazing experience, and also playing at the Millennium Stadium, which was a huge stadium, big capacity. I don't even think all the fans would have fitted at the Racecourse grounds. I don't know. We should look at the numbers, but yeah. And then before the game, I was actually starting on the bench for that game, but I knew that Steve Roberts, who was starting ahead of me at the time, was struggling in the warm-up. I had a little chat with him, and I was like, hey, he told me he's struggling a little bit with some injury. So my mentality, even though I was starting on the bench, was, okay, I've got to get ready mentally. I've got to keep warm, because you never know, it might come on at any point. And then I think it was in the first 10 to 15 minutes of the match, the game started, Steve Roberts came off injured. He was like, oh, I can't carry on. So I came on the pitch and ended up playing from there, from like 10 minutes into the game, which, being a sub coming onto the pitch in the first 10 minutes, especially a defender, is tough to get to the pace of the game and not try and screw up anyway. But I felt like I was mentally ready for it and came on and ended up having a pretty good game. And we ended up winning the game, which was even more of an experience, winning in Cardiff, winning that cup. Lifting the trophy, getting a medal was something I'll never forget. It was an amazing experience.
Around about the time then, when you left Wrexham, did you want to leave Wrexham to start a different path, or did you feel that you had a lot more going for Wrexham?
When I left, I had like a difficult time for the last year or two before I left. I was kind of in and out of the team. I felt like things weren't quite working between myself and the managers at the time. There was a lot of change of managers for the last 2 years I was there. Brian Little came in and Dean Saunders came in, and there was a lot of new faces coming in. The club was going to go through this transition period of trying to get promotion back into League Two. And for me, I wasn't playing as much as I would have liked to play during that period. So obviously, if you're not playing, you need to find a club that respects you and want to play at. So yeah, I ended up leaving. I went to York City for a little bit, ended up playing for them. And then, like I said earlier, I got this bug to want to go play somewhere else in the world. And North America was something that I was really interested in at the time. So yeah, I ended up going to a few different clubs and then, like I said, played for Vancouver Whitecaps, and then the rest is history from there.
Crystal Palace Baltimore, what kind of club is that?
Yeah, that was a weird experience. Yeah, it was actually a dark time in my life. Sadly, I don't want to go into too much details, but no, yeah, came to Vancouver, played for Vancouver for the remainder of the season, played every game, played really well. We ended up getting to the playoff finals, but we ended up unfortunately getting beat in the playoff finals. And then, and then this new team in the league, this brand new team called Crystal Palace Baltimore. It was obviously based in Baltimore in the US. They came to me and they were like, "Hey, we want to sign you. We've got this new team where we want to invest money. We want to get this new team of youngish guys at the time to play and kind of put our mark on this league." And I signed for like a 2-year deal there. They valued me, but I moved down to Baltimore, not really knowing much about the area. I don't know if you've seen The Wire on TV shows, but it's some rough parts in Baltimore. I was this like kind of youngish kind of Welsh English guy in the middle of Baltimore, a bit nervous. But after like about 2 or 3 months of going down there and signing for this team, they ended up going bankrupt and there's no team anymore. So I was stuck in Baltimore by myself. I was like, "Oh shit, now what do I do?"
I could just picture it, right, with you just like, "Oh, do you want to come and sign for Crystal Palace?" And it's just like, "What?" And he went, "Oh, no, Baltimore."
Exactly. I know. Yeah. Yeah. You saw on paper Crystal Palace and then like in little brackets, Baltimore. I'm like, "Wait, what?"
It's Baltimore. It's okay. Know, yeah. But you finished around the time when you finished your career, you came back to Wales, but you came and played for Bangor City. How did that happen? And I think it was around about the time where Bangor were just sort of at the top of, you know, being the next competitor for TNS, which was Steve's previous club when he signed for. What was that like to go and play for Bangor City in the Welsh, in the League of Wales, or the Welsh Premier League, it was called at the time?
Yeah, like I said, it was a weird time in my life. I was just dealing with all this Baltimore shenanigans. And I had this text from Dave Bayliss, who was at the time the Barrow manager. So I went there to train and to try and get my fitness back up and to try and get back into playing football. Didn't work out. And then, I ended up going to Bangor, which was good, actually. I really enjoyed my time at Bangor, playing in the Welsh League. Was kind of going back in years of like going back to the Welsh roots of that level of playing, and the fans at Bangor were great. They were very passionate, and it was a good team. Really enjoyed my time out there. To be honest, my mental state wasn't at the what it was like 10 years prior playing for Wrexham. I was at that weird kind of low in my career where I was struggling mentally from like all this Crystal Palace era and dealing with all the shenanigans of being out of a job for like over a year and that type of stuff. So mentally I wasn't quite there, but enjoyed my time there. It was great to play again with the Welsh fans and have that support. We ended up having a pretty decent year. We had some up and down moments, but it was a good team of lads, and the fans were, like I said, very passionate and banger too. So it was good to play in the Welsh League for at least a year.
So how did you get this job then with the FIFA 21 and all that stuff? So how did that come about then?
It's a weird one. Like when I came to Vancouver to play for them, I ended up meeting a girl out here in Vancouver. She was from the US. So she moved with me to Baltimore. When I moved to Baltimore, she left Vancouver to come with me. Ended up getting married, and settling down in Baltimore. Then, but when we were living in Vancouver, she actually worked for Electronic Arts. She was in video games at the time.
Oh, you lucky guy.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, it worked out. So kind of it happened because of a girl, I should say. Cutting a long story short. She ended up, as I was playing for Bangor at the time, my then kind of fiance wife got this opportunity to go back to Vancouver to work back at Electronic Arts. And part of the deal was to take me with me. So I was like, I mean, great opportunity to go back to Vancouver with like an open visa to do what the hell I wanted to do in Vancouver and kind of start again. Cause at the time I was like playing for Bangor and my mind wasn't quite right in the football. I was in that kind of dark period of not enjoying football as much as I used to do. So I kind of wanted a fresh start and to start again. And then came to Vancouver and obviously I played video games, played FIFA a lot as being a footballer. Walked into the office and had a chat with some guys at Vancouver in the EA campus. And it worked out. Managed to get a role and they invested in me and taught me the ropes. It was obviously a difficult challenge going from playing the game, being outside training all the time to then sitting in an office. That was a difficult transition, but it was a great experience to learn how to make video games and what goes on behind the scenes. It's quite a difficult challenge to make video games, but really enjoyable at the same time.
I bet you got the recent copy of FIFA 21 then.
Yeah, I've had it for a while. Been working on FIFA now for the last 8 years, which has been really, really great experience. Really smart people I work with. Getting quite good at the game now, which is good.
I expect mine in the post right now. Last question for you then, Shaun, and it's I'm really grateful that you actually found the time just to come on and just talk about your career for Wrexham and Wales into 21. It's been an absolute pleasure. So here's the final question for you is, how do you sum up your career?
Sum it up? Highs and lows. It started high for me. It ended up some waves of emotions. But yeah, I think playing for a Welsh club in Wrexham, obviously, and then playing for the Welsh national team, having that kind of Welsh kind of background, especially with my mum's side of the family being Welsh, was something that was really I'm proud of, and I'm happy to have played high level at Wrexham, and then obviously with the Welsh team, and my parents obviously proud, I think, and that was something that I'm proud of myself, and I think it was great having that Welsh kind of history, that background. And I need to get some Welsh flags in my Vancouver home now so I can represent the Welsh community out in Canada.
I think the Canadians will probably know a lot more about Wales than what America, because I had Jonathan Brown in a few days ago, and because he's playing for Oklahoma Energy and he's a Bridgend lad, he was saying to me, oh yeah, I've had that. Oh, it's Wales in England, or it's Wales this, it's Wales that. You must have had that as well, you know. It's going, no, it's his own country, it's okay.
Yeah, people are saying, I used to play for Wales, and they're like, wait, that thing that swims in the ocean? They're like, they've got no idea. I'm like, no. How do you pay for that? But yeah, so I need some more education out here on Wales, but I'm doing my best to try and educate the Canadians.
That's absolutely fantastic. We love the Canadians anyway, so.
Yeah, they're very nice people, but they need some history on Wales.
Well, Shaun, thank you so much for coming on Dragon's Voice podcast. It means a lot for you to come on just to talk about career. So want to just wish you all the very best, and can't wait for my FIFA now.
That was good. I think it'll be a game.
All right. Thank you very much, Shaun. So guys, that was Shaun Pejic in the Dragon's Voice podcast, and I'm doing so well with the pronunciations. I'm getting good at this now, but guys, I hope you really enjoyed it as much as I am doing these podcasts, and it's keeping me going mentally as well, because with the podcast, I love my football, I love Welsh football, and guys like Shaun and anyone else who has played, they're doing their fair share for Welsh football. So you can't go wrong with that. So I just want to say thank you for the support. Give it a like, share, subscribe to the videos, and follow me on Twitter at DragonsVoice20. And Shaun, have you got yourself I know you got a Twitter account, so how do the people follow you then?
Yeah, let's do it. Yeah, hook me up and we'll connect on Twitter.
Yeah. So what's your Twitter account on that?
I think it's just Shaun Pej, I think is the one. To be honest, I don't use it very often, so I wouldn't be ashamed if you don't follow me.
Yeah. Hey, no worries. But anyway, guys, thank you so much for tuning in. I've been your host, Julie Rees-Deans, and I'll see you all very soon. Take care.